Good evening, guys. Hope you hear me fine.
Yes.
Hope I don't need a mic. Thank you.
You want more light or is it like that?
Yeah, sorry?
You want more light or you like the...
I think it's fine. Yeah. So, welcome to the last session of MonkeyFest, for the first day of MonkeyFest. Thanks to the sponsors, because of them, we have it as a free event. You guys know how it started, right?
Yeah.
How much you had to pay to attend this session?
$1,000, yes.
Yeah.
I said the price.
So
tell you why, it's just because we wanted to fly the speakers just on planes, wanted to have them a nice hotel with nice room, wanted to have a nice reunion in Sentosa, and a party in the studio with rides and everything. And that was not cheap. So, but that didn't work, so therefore, it.
It would have been great there as well.
We expect more.
Because of the sponsors, we are able to attend to this event for free,
which
with
is
free
nice.
Food
which
and all.
Good, right? Right.
So, I'm just thanking them.
And also thank you for the speakers. All the speakers are basically speaking for free and they're paying for that flight from their own pocket money. Is that the one who works for my
friend? Yeah, thanks to them as well.
We appreciate it.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. We'll support
them. So with that, let's get into the topic. Accelerating Xamarin development. It is not about how you improve the performance of your application. It is about how you improve the development process itself, how you can speed up. See, typically in any development environment, in a fast-paced world, we are always chased by the deadline, and often we forget to sharpen our axe. For so little output, we struggle a lot and burn ourselves. So this session is more about to think and sharpen our axe. So who am I? My name is Arul, Arul Kumaran. I'm the CTO of LuraCast, a company which develops software development solutions and tools and gives open source solutions as well for free. I'm a mobile developer since the J2ME days. I've done games with J2ME on the Nokia phones and all, if you guys remember those days. Yeah, so I started those days and I love Xamarin. And I love developing native iOS application with Xamarin and with Swift and all. While I was into the client side, I developed a framework for the server side to easily create an API. So I'm the author of the Wrestler REST API framework, which is open source and used by so many people. It is written in PHP. And I'm a very active community member of the Singapore development community. Some of you might have seen me in other developer events as well, if you are into those events. So let's talk about how we can increase the development speed without burning ourselves. So this is going to be more of a session where I'm the host than the presenter. So it needs to be an interactive session. So let us come out with so many solutions that can help the developer to speed up the development process without burning themselves. Okay? So we can think about various ways, right? Let us start from the basics. So we can use general techniques that can be applied for any development process, right? Any software development process, whatever things that we can use to speed up, to improve the process, we can use the same, right? You can use that as a basis to come up with something. And then any general mobile development techniques can be applied to Xamarin as well, right? And then we can take a look at things that are very specific to Xamarin and how we can speed up there. Okay, so when we talk about general techniques, what we can do. So we can find existing components, templates that solves a problem. So instead of we spending time developing something, we can just simply use them. So what I suggest is, like, if you have a team of say four, where you have some developers and designers and whatnot as a team. So if you work as in sprint and all, I suggest every Friday before leaving, just spend 2 hours on finding something to improve your workflow. What you can do to speed up. Find some new tools, check something out, right? If it is interesting, those 2 hours are just to trigger your curiosity to look at something. There are so many things happening, right? There are new tools. Most often we won't get time, and mostly they won't run fine also. So you won't simply be able to introduce something, some cool new tool into your production environment. It takes time, right? So just take a look at them and experiment, figure out how they work, and whether they can be used on your day-to-day development process. Okay, so first is finding some existing component and template, right? Then what else we can do? We should not think about, like, too much about the future and create something too complex that can be applied everywhere. Instead, just focus on writing a minimal solution that will get the job done for that particular project. Usually developers have this problem. What they have is, like, whenever they start developing, they will think, okay, can I add this feature so that later on, if at all client asks that, I'll just turn it on and it'll work. Otherwise, even if it is not used in this project, if I make it robust enough, then I can just take and plug and play on another project also, right? We often do this. I'm one of them in terms of that, right? So we have to limit ourselves to just the feature that is needed for that particular application. And then the next one will contradict with this. So we need to find a balance. So what I'm saying is, like, we need to reuse. We have to write everything as reusable components so that anytime you need a similar one, you just take and plug and play that there. So this can contradict with the previous one, right? So we need to find a balance between these two. Write something that can just do the job and be a component by itself, which can be taken out and put in. So write in a component way so that you can just take and use it again. And then if you are the only developer in a project, how you write code may not matter much. It will affect the performance, of course. Other than that, you know what you write and you will be able to modify. But when there are more developers in a project, it is always good to follow some design pattern. That way, you don't have to put in so much effort to document how that particular thing works and how to write code and how to understand an existing code and all, because you follow a pattern. If they know the pattern, they know how to continue working with your code. Right? And then wherever we can automate the process, we should automate. If machine can do it, just give it to the machine, let it do it. So most often we can automate the tests. Instead of we running through the test again and again, we can just use the machine to do the test and get us the result. So in order to see where and how we can optimize, we have to understand the workflow, right? So the mobile development starts with gathering the information. So we understand what is required, and then we give a proposal. When the client accepts it, we start the design and development, right? So if we gather the requirement correctly, most of our problems won't be there. Any gap we leave there will bite us in the ass later on. So wherever they can fill in, whatever wording you use to define what will be delivered, right, any gap in there is going to be a problem for us. So write your requirement as clearly as possible, and ideally put up some screens that explain, some wireframes that explain, like, okay, this screen will be like this and this is what it will do, right? Any ambiguity you leave there is going to be a problem, so put in as much effort as possible there. That will save you a lot of time and trouble and heartache. So properly estimating how much time it will take is again required. We'll start with the right estimation and then client will push us. Then we'll say, okay, we'll speed up. We'll somehow deliver it with half the time that is actually required, right? If at all we can deliver it in half the time, it shouldn't be at the cost of our this thing, right? So whatever normal time that requires, that is required for a project, we have to code for that and somehow get that. If at all you can speed up, that's your gain. That's how it should be, right? For a development house. Okay. And then the design process. There are a lot of tools nowadays, right? So you may be designing in Photoshop or what other tools you guys use?
Yeah.
Sketch. A lot of people are into Sketch nowadays. Anything else? Any other graphic design tool that you guys use? Photoshop, Sketch, anything else? Okay, you use that. Okay, good. Yeah, so from Sketch, most often you take it to InVision and create a complete flow where people can click through and see how the application will function before even the application is built, right? So that is a good way as well. So when you are designing, you put it in InVision or similar tool. There are other tools as well that are similar to InVision, where you can put the screenshots and then define where you will click and where it will take. So you can define the complete workflow. They can get the feel of the application before it is built. So then comes the development process. We will see how we can optimize it. Actually, using Xamarin, that itself saves us a lot of time in terms of development, because we can keep a lot of our code in a shared portion of the application, right? Instead of writing the same backend for iOS, Android, and Windows Phone separately and maintaining them, we all write it in C hash and keep it in a common place. And if at all we can use Xamarin Forms, that even adds more to the savings, right? Because the UI is also written in a common layer, which is easy to maintain. And then testing is where we can use automation and all to save some time. And it has to be done in a loop continuously, so that anything that goes wrong, we will find it quickly and fix it. And then the launch and approval by the client and all happens after that. So this is the loop that I suggest we go through to find out some bottlenecks and come out with some solutions. So we have to identify a bottleneck and then come up with a shortcut that can help us avoid that bottleneck. And then we can tweak the workflow, the way we do things. We can shift it a little bit so that we can use the shortcut, and for that we can use the tools that are available today. So what I will do is I will take you through this loop with one example. What I want you guys to do is take another problem and let's run through this loop and find a solution. We can come up with a lot of solutions. So do this every Friday. It'll be fun. Instead of doing the same work and under the pressure again and again, just spend some time. It will definitely save you a lot of time and make development as a fun process again. So, one of the bottleneck. What happens with our the designer hands us some design, we tweak, and then we find a bug, we fix it, we compile it, and then deploy it on the device, and then test it. So this is like a long process. I used to be in the animation industry. So there we have a process like which is called rendering. So you create some 3D animation, you keep your models and then animate them. After everything is done, you set the properties, how the lighting and everything should be there, and you put some skin for the creatures and define the properties, how glassy the material should be and all. After all those things are done, you will go through a process called rendering. That is your coffee break. You start that, it can take hours. Once it finishes, you finish your coffee and then come back, take a look. Oh, this doesn't look like the way I want it. Again, start the loop. So it is not very different from what we do, right? One small mistake, you have to again compile the whole application and then deploy it and then test it. Such a waste. So this is where most of our time goes off, right? So this is one thing I identify as a bottleneck. So how can we avoid this? So are there tools that can help us see the result instantly? If at all we can identify such tools and use them, we can avoid lot of, we can save a lot of time. Instead of going through this loop, we can see the result instantly. So are there such tools? And if we can find the tool, again, another thing what we can do is like we can tweak the workflow. So if you take a web developer and designer, usually a web designer means he will handle the HTML, right? He doesn't give you a Photoshop design and just tell you like, okay, take this and implement it in HTML. Now the designers are very good. They understand HTML and they can put the design in. If it is your .NET code in between, they can just fill up the HTML and pass it to you. So you just put the dynamic elements there and your page is ready, right? So the developers are, the designers are so good, they can handle HTML. If they can do that, they can handle XAML as well. But then the problem is, I don't want to go through the compilation. And you can see, even the pros are failing at it. Just in the previous session, right? IDE, when it will render fine, when it will crash, when it will throw an error, we don't know, right? Suddenly, just by changing the theme, the things that used to work before are not working. So that is the problem with which they are not able to take it at all. I cannot really see the preview, right? It's difficult. So if we can fix that problem, there is a XAML preview in the IDE itself, right? There are ways to make it work. If we learn that and make it work, it is easier to edit the XAML and immediately see the preview there. So that is one solution. If we can make it work. What else we can do? Here are some of the tools of the trade that I would recommend. This is surely not a complete list. Some of the tools that I come across. So I often go through what is new, how it works, and how it can help me, right? So this is what I saw. And the first tool is not a big, you all are familiar with ReSharper, right? How many of you use ReSharper? Okay, how many of you heard about ReSharper and not using it yet? Okay, so the minus point about ReSharper is like it is Windows only, right? So if you're using Windows, you can use it. I'm a Mac user, I don't use Windows. So I couldn't use that. So I love the features that are available in ReSharper, but I'm not able to use them yet. So what you can do with a good IDE, Visual Studio itself provides a lot of good features, especially if you use the Windows version. The Mac version is catching up. It is still in alpha stage, but it is improving. It is it is cloned from Xamarin IDE, and now we're getting more features there. With the help of ReSharper, you can do code analysis. You can do refactorings very fast. And you can quickly navigate between the classes, and you can search for something quickly. And you can automatically do the code formatting, so code becomes very readable in a standard way. So every time before you commit the code, you just format it and then commit it. That way, the code standards can be maintained. And it can generate the code also. So if you are subclassing something, if it has to implement certain methods, it will just put them there. So you can just write the code. It will be much faster with them. So this is what I am using. Rider is a cross-platform IDE from the same guys who made ReSharper. So JetBrains have come up with an IDE that works on Linux, Windows, and Mac. Currently, it is still in a preview, so it is not complete yet. It has its own glitches, but it is available for free now. You can download and try. So I'm often using it. Whenever it works well. So if at all it works for a project, I will use that. It saves me a lot of time. And because I'm using so many of their IDEs already, I use PHP Storm, WebStorm, and other IDEs. It is using the same keyboard shortcuts and other things. So it is very native for me to work with that IDE. So give it a try. It is written in .NET as well. OK, this is my favorite. How many of you are using Xamarin Workbooks? OK, only one. Nobody else is using Xamarin Workbooks? Xamarin Workbooks and Inspector. How many of you heard about Xamarin Workbooks? OK. It's a pretty awesome tool. I really love it. What it does is it helps you write some code and also write some documentation along. And you can immediately run that and see the result instantly. So in many languages, we use a tool called REPL. Do you guys know what is REPL? Read, evolve, and print loop. Okay, with that, you can quickly test something and see the result and then proceed. So it is such a tool for C#. So you want to test a small portion of your C# code that you are writing for the command line, or you are writing an iOS application and something is bothering you, some layout is not working fine. Working in isolation can help you solve it pretty quickly. So I'm not going to show much of a demo today, but for this one, I have few. So this is one of the problems that I solved. I was working on an iOS application, which is written natively. So no Xamarin forms there. So where I need to create a layout, where I need to lay out these buttons there. If it is iPad, if it has more width, it has to fill up there and then wrap around. So in order to test this, to see whether it works on different screen sizes and all, I had to spend a lot of time. After that, when I came to know about Xamarin Workbooks, I just took the class that basically formats them and puts them in order, and then added some test code, and I was running it through Workbooks. Let me see if I have that running. So this is a running version of that, and here is the workbook. So basically, I created a class label list view, which extends UI view. In that, I have written some code which loops through and lays out how these buttons have to be arranged and all. As you can see in workbook, basically when you start with, so let me just start with something new. Say I want to create a workbook for the console. So it comes up with this. If at all I want to write some documentation, I can just add a documentation cell where I can say, how many of you guys use Markdown? So all of you know what is Markdown? No, not many of you know what is Markdown. OK, let me explain that also. That will help. Basically, HTML is a markup, right? So you decorate HTML, where like you decorate the text with so many tags so that it renders beautifully. You decorate it with a H1 tag, so it becomes a title. And then you can put bullet points with OL, LI tags and all. So that's how you render some document beautifully, by adding more tags, right? Markdown is an attempt to write less but render beautifully. OK? Say, for example, I want to say, so this is my title. Okay, so I'm saying this is a heading. Actually, what they have done is like they have implemented an IDE kind of like features to type that, but internally it is saving it as a file with a hash in front that becomes the title. So this is the title. And then I can add some bullet points. Point one, point two. And I don't want the code in front, so let me just delete it. Okay. So this is what I've written. It looks like a Word document, right? It looks, it renders nicely. So let me just save it. OK, let me save it to the desktop. Let me open Visual Studio Code to open the same file, see what is inside. OK, so it has some header that tells what to load and what is the title and which platform it has to be run. If you are creating a workbook for iOS, the platform will be iOS. Now we are creating a console application. That's why it has that in the header. So just ignore that. Putting a hash makes it a title. Putting a star in front makes it a point. So that's how this document is written, right? You can add a code block. If you read the Markdown syntax, you will understand. So if I just triggered your curiosity towards Markdown, that's good enough for me. Just go and take a look at how to write Markdown. I do all my documentation with Markdown nowadays. That saves me a lot of time. So you don't need a special editor. With a plain text editor, you can type quickly and get beautiful documentation out of it. That is Markdown. And Xamarin Workbooks is using Markdown internally to render the document beautifully, as well as put the code there. So now that I've shown you that, let's go back to the, now I can add a code block. So here I can write a single line of C# code. When I enter, it will execute and I will see the result in the next line. Okay, that's how it works. So which line should I be like putting there? Some C# code, some console code, anyone? I'm just going to type what you're going to say.
Console.type line. Console.type line.
Okay. So it does autocomplete also for you. Okay, so it just renders that. So I can declare a variable and then create a function and then pass the variable to the function and see what is the output, right? So once I've written it, it can be saved as a workbook and this can be shared with anyone. So I was talking about how we can store code, right? Like keep code as a reusable component. So you are solving a particular problem. Don't solve it in a complex application. Then you cannot easily share it with anyone. Even if you find a bug in Xamarin, how do you report it back? Will you pass your proprietary application to the guys to see what the problem is? If you can isolate the problem that you're working in with Xamarin workbook, is very, very good. You can pass it to anyone. Just pass this workbook to anyone. They can run this. Okay? So this is a small sample, right? Let me just close this. Let's go back to this example. So first I'm creating a class and then what I'm doing is like I'm creating an array of strings. So I'm just declaring this. When I press enter, it executes and this is what I get. So that's what is there in that system.string array. And then I'm creating an instance of this label list view and pass the array there, right? I store it in a variable called v. So this is the output of that. And after that, so I just put it on the screen. So if you write a native iOS application in Xcode or Swift or Xcode or C#, you will understand this code. Otherwise, don't bother much. It is just using a UI view and adding a subview there with which I've created this. So if at all you rotate this view, you can see that it tries to fit in the available space. Okay. So you can change the device in which you are rendering it. If at all I want to change the color of something, I can change it there. So background color is set here, right? So let me make it 0.5 and then execute it again. You can see that this one has become less transparent, so you can see the color. So anything that you want to change, you can change instantly and then execute it and see the result there. So anything in terms of UI and all that you want to work on, you can use this to test that. It is not just for the UI. Even if you're working with some server-side API, say for example, I was creating an application that consumes WordPress API. So I want to test a library which consumes that. So I created a workbook for that. that loads and shows me the output. Otherwise, in order to see that output, I have to put a breakpoint and then hit that breakpoint. Then I see what is there, right? So let me see if I have that workbook with me. I'm not sure if it is that. Okay. I'll be changing the password anyway, so don't bother copying it. Okay, so this is one of the problems that I had. Actually, like, I need to use a library, a PCL file, that gives the WordPress client. Workbook has one bug where I couldn't import something like that. And it works sometimes, it doesn't work sometimes. So when it works good. So I could test that. Now it is saying that it couldn't find the namespace. So I couldn't show you what it does. Basically, like, when I say list posts, it'll get all the posts and I can see the result there. So this helps me to figure out what is happening with the API without passing it through the whole application. So in terms of isolating the problem and fixing it, this is really a very handy tool. Okay. So next one is Xamarin Live Player. Yep. Sorry, can you repeat that again? You can test it. Test XAML as well. I've done that as well. XAML is basically an XML that you can load and create UI from, right? Previously, that was the only way the application used to work. Now they have a way to compile that into the C# code. So you can do that as well. So you can test the view using that. In fact, along with the workbook, they have another thing called inspector, right? So when you are testing this, let me hear it. You will be able to see the layout as well, like the way that the layers are structured. That also you can see. Okay. I'll skip that for now. I will let you figure out how to do that. So you can do that. You can test the XAML layout, tweak them also by running it through the workbook. And inspector basically works within your application. So you can pass anytime and then tweak it in real time. But this requires enterprise license. That is the only constraint there, which is costly, I guess. I never attempted to buy that, so I haven't tried. The next one is Xamarin Live Player. How many of you are using Xamarin Live Player? Okay, only one. Nobody else tried it? Okay, what it does is basically, it allows you to do live edits on your view and even the C# code and see the changes directly on your device. So how you use Xamarin Live Player? Basically, you need to download Xamarin Live Player for iOS or Android on the device itself, and then activate them as a plugin for Visual Studio in Windows or the preview version in Mac. You have to enable the Live Player, and then from your desktop screen, there will be a barcode which you have to scan from your player application. Once you have done that, it will connect these two. Once they are connected, then the Live Player will be one of the devices that you can deploy your application to. So you can select the Live Player, which is in your iPhone or something. So you just select that, and then you can run debug and all, then you will be able to see the application. It doesn't take time to do the whole compile cycle. So it does incremental compilation and sends that code there, and it runs. It has some limitation in terms of what you can do, but it does work most of the time. So if you understand the limitations, basically, like, if you are using some standard classes are already compiled and inside the live player. If you cannot subclass them in your test application. So if you know those rules and play by those rules, you'll be able to instantly test your application using the live player. It will keep on improving. It is just launched recently, and every version they keep improving it. So this is one thing that you need to look for. Okay. So another thing similar to the Xamarin player is called a Gorilla player. It is not from Microsoft. It is from a third-party vendor. It does similar stuff. Basically, you install the Gorilla player on your device, and then connect it to your. You need to install a plugin on your Visual Studio, and then connect these two. After that, you can see live XAML preview. This one is more specifically written for XAML. So, in your Visual Studio, you open a XAML page. Immediately, you will see the preview of that XAML page on your device. That's how it works. So, spend some time with that. If you can make it work, it will help you.
How fast is it compared to the emulators?
It's very fast. It doesn't emulate, it just immediately gives you the preview. So you just edit it, save, you see the preview there. So that way you save a lot of time editing your XAML code. Okay. There is another player as well. And this one, what it does basically is like your Chrome developer tools for XAML. So again, you need to there is a NuGet package that you need to use, and then compile it and connect the IDE to the. There is a desktop application that you need to run for the UI sleuth. Once you connect these two, you can see the preview of your running application. You may be running the application in emulator, or you may be running it directly on the device. You will see the preview there, and you will be able to see the structure and then edit them and all. I recommend strongly spending some time on this, because this one is open source. I was talking to the developer, because I like such projects. He was telling me, like, I was telling them, telling him, I want to talk about this product in MonkeyFest. And he said, I don't know whether I will continue it. It's just a fun project. I don't know whether I will continue it. I don't know whether I will update it for every Xamarin version and all. So I asked him, like, can you just open source it so people like me can take a look and contribute and continue developing on it? That time he said, okay, let me see. And recently, like day before yesterday, I was looking at, and I can see that it's already open source. Everything is there up in GitHub. So if you can understand the code and modify it, so any problem that you find, you may be able to fix it also. So check it out. Okay, so that is one loop that I taken you through. So how long we have now?
It's around 6 o'clock. So we have 15 minutes or so. 17 minutes. Yeah. No, this is...
Okay, that's 5 minutes late, actually. So, yeah. So, I think with the time that is available now, we can go through one more loop. You guys are ready for that? So, any problem that you identify with which we can start and then try to find some solution? Yeah.
We face a lot of problem with binding libraries.
Okay, okay.
Because we import a lot of Android libraries.
Okay.
That's why you use a binding library, right?
Okay.
You have to do a lot of
workarounds for putting in another tags. Okay. So let me see if I understand it correctly. You want to use some native Xamarin components, some native Android components, for which there needs to be a Xamarin binding that helps it to like put in along with the application.
There is already one, but just that it doesn't do a clean job.
Okay.
You have to do a lot of work around, because sometimes it, because the way Java is written and the way Java is written, the syntax and other things.
Okay, okay. So basically, like just they just take the Java code and try to convert it into C#, and that is where some problems come in, right? Yeah, in places like this, code generation can help. So, if people are if you can differentiate, you can find the difference between how a Java code is written and how C# has to be written in terms of inheritance, and there are some various in between these two languages, right? So, if you can understand that, you can come up with a code generator that can write the code for you. So if any binding that is available for Java, you can just take that and it will automatically give you a C# binding that can solve that problem, right? Let me see if I...
Arun.
Yeah.
So far there is no converter left, right? It's still subject to, you know, engineering, but rather not having automatic transformation.
Somebody has to put in effort, right? Who will put in and what he will gain? That is where the problem is, right? So if all of us can contribute a little bit of time towards that, and if we are skilled enough to do that, the problem will be solved.
But we need the translator and interpreter to really, you know, come to understand the basic problem.
I want to show a tools guys have developed, which is like awesome, that can, I couldn't remember the domain now. Basically, like any JSON file, it can automatically generate the C# code for that, the class and how to call the, get the data and all. You guys remember that domain? Is there? No, that was the old one. There is a new one, which is pretty awesome. I liked it. I just tried it recently, but it's an IO domain, .io. If you guys remember that, we can just load, and I would like to show that to all of you. Anyway, so ideally, if we can find a code generator that can solve this particular problem, right? Anything else? Shall we start with one more loop like that? Okay. If you guys are thinking, I will come up with one more problem. So, see, how many of you do web development as well? Some of you. So you guys know there are some web components. Otherwise, you'll be like spending a lot of time writing HTML application, right? There is Twitter's Bootstrap, and then a lot of companies writing themes using Bootstrap. So nowadays, if you want to create a new clean web application, you don't have to be a designer. You just go take Twitter Bootstrap or any other CSS framework, or even better, there are themes, and people are selling themes for like $16, $24 and all. You just go find some theme that is like good for you as a starting point. Take that theme and then build the whole website with that. It already looks clean. Further, you may have to like add few images that are like specific to you, and then tweak the colors here and there. That's it. It's done, right? So do we have a similar solution for Xamarin development? Will you guys will you be using such a solution if it is available? What do you guys think? Anyone using any Xamarin template theme? No one? Okay. I did try that as well. So there are not so many players in this space. I want them there. So if you are a good designer, you can generate a lot of XAML code, create complete teams with all the screens that are required for typical applications, and then sell them cheap, right? They are not selling cheap, but still you may find them useful. So Grail UI is from the same guys who made the Gorilla player. So they have like different layouts and all. So what I did is, basically I charge by the hour. So my client said I need to spend less hours and develop a WordPress application, like WordPress client for them with Xamarin. Then I told him, okay, buy this theme and then tell me which page in your application should follow which theme. He told me, and then I built the application and gave it to him. So he got it for cheap. He just had to buy this theme. Put together, it works out cheap for him. And I also don't have to like spend so much time thinking about the design, tweaking the design. Yeah, after taking this, again it's XAML, right? So further, if at all you need to tweak it, you can tweak it. You can spend some time changing things here and there. But the basic stuff is already there. That saves me a lot of time. I don't want to be a designer there, right? I'm a bad designer. If at all you give something to me, I will just move it 1 pixel and then compile and see. No. 2 pixel down and then compile and see. See, developers are more perfectionists. They are not fit for a designer. That's what I feel. Okay? Yeah.
So, all these are commercially.
Yeah, this is a commercial. There are few, like some people have put it on GitHub. If you search, you can find them as well. Actually, this can be a giant effort also. Like everybody can just, like the 2 hours on Friday, just design one thing and then put it up. Yeah. Okay, so you have the URL?
Yes,
N. SNPPTS.io, is it?
There are a few open source
tools. Oh, okay. So here is your answer. I never knew about this. So this is a good thing about talking about these topics, you know.
Yeah, I mentioned that tomorrow.
Yeah. So I also gained something today. If somebody starts a website like that, we can also add our stuff there. So everybody gains from them. Okay. Do we have time for one more loop, or do you guys have any problem that needs to be solved? Okay.
Is that the correct one that I
will
be looking for?
No. This is that's a different one.
That is
if I find it, I will show that as well. That is pretty cool.
Okay.
So you want to write your application in Swift or TypeScript or C#, it can generate the code. Just copy paste your JSON there. It will give you the code, including how to import that, how to make a call and get that, call the API, get the data into the classes that you want.
Would you have that by tomorrow?
If this presentation is shared, and with that I can put the URL also. So it's not a big deal. So, yeah, we had the discussion so far, right? So do you have any question, or you want to discuss about anything?
I'm a bit new to Xamarin, but I want to learn. I'm a Python developer myself. I have 2 questions.
Okay.
Xamarin is making use of C# only. Is there any plan for it to support that?
You can use the F# as well. Yeah, currently these two are the mainly supported ones.
Okay, one more question. Can you develop submarine apps without using those Azure? Because we know that you have to pay for it.
Yeah, yeah. Any Azure services and all, whatever payment that you need to do for that, you can
develop standalone apps.
Yeah, you can. It is not tied. If you want to use them together, there are many integrations that will help you get your development pretty fast. But it is not tied. You don't have to use them. It is up to you. So it is completely available for free after it was taken over by Microsoft. So you can use it. You can use your own backend, whatever technology.
So if you want to use Azure, you can get away with using the free tier on Azure for a lot of stuff. A lot of the apps are the free tier version.
Okay.
There is a website called Python.io.
Sorry?
There is Jameson called Python.
Quick type, is it?
Yeah.
I think so.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, this is the website I was talking about. Take note of that as well, which is an improvement from what I used to use before. So basically, you just copy paste your JSON here, and then it will convert that into whatever type that you want. So currently it is converting it into TypeScript. So if I want it to convert it into Go language or Swift and all, I can do. Let me do C sharp for you. So you can say what namespace you want and all. After that, it generates all the partial classes required. And then it also serializing from JSON. So the entire the code that you will use is here. You just copy paste them. Yeah.
Is your current project that you're working on, or the forthcoming project that you're working on?
Current projects are basically like all some backend projects, and some are using Xamarin Form, some are using iOS, native iOS applications and all. So I have my business card with me. Feel free to grab my card. And if you are curious about anything, want to talk about the problems that you solved or problems you want to solve, feel free to reach me out. Thank you.